The Christmas Bride by Charles Nicholas Trivis. Read in English. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. The Christmas Bride, the old story so often told of true love and a world so cold. One Christmas day my tale begins, loud and joyous the church chime rings. A bride so fair, yet pensive sad, while on this day all seemed glad, except this one, for she had fled against her parents' wish to wed the one who now stands by her side. She gave up all to be his bride. Home, parents, friends, and comforts too, in the small village where she grew to be the joy and pride of all who knew of her, both great and small. She was a teacher, and the best. Her pupils loved her with the rest. And John, dear, loving, honest boy, to him she was his every joy. He had loved her long and well, more dear to him than tongue could tell. Her every wish was to him law, nor could he in her see a flaw. Poor boy, she liked him, but then he did not impress as some men whom she had seen and heard about, though he was manly, true, and stout of heart, and always ready, too, to serve her just the best he knew. She admired him and all his ways, but then her eyes before his gaze could not meet his, for there she read what at that time she wished unsaid, much too tender to cause him pain or treat his love with cold disdain, for another one held all her thought, but this to hide from John she sought, for he had come one summer day and stole poor Mamie's heart away. In him she fancied she had found the hero which her dreams had crowned. He was tall, dashing in his ways, spoke soft and low, nor stinted praise, and o'er her mind he had full sway. John was forgotten from that day. All took him for the favored swain, until the city stranger came, stole her from him and all beside, on Christmas Day to be his bride. The same old story often told, she'd taken the dross for the gold. Time alone its tale would tell, reveal what others knew quite well, that he was a most depraved knave, to gambling and all vice the slave. Her eyes opened, but when too late, to save herself from such a fate. She was, alas, a gambler's wife, for better or worse all her life. The worse and not the better came, although she tried just the same to win him from his wickedness, his gambling, and his drunkenness. A sad awakening indeed was hers, days spent in wretchedness and tears. And far along into the night, waiting, watching for the dread sight, the hero of her dreams uncrowned, her bright hopes dashed to the ground. Many a Christmas come and go, bringing little joy and much woe. First a baby girl, then a boy, these constituted all her joy. Long years have passed, years of pain, and Christmas time has come again. What changes in those years have come to Mamie, daughter and son? A widow now, and in distress, her husband left her penniless. 5 years ago he passed away, but she has managed till this day to meet the wants of those she loved, a heavy task, and one that proved too great a load for her frail form, with sickness, grief, and anguish worn. The boy, a sturdy little lad, to lend his help was ever glad. His sister, with her loving care, her mother's anguish tried to share. Sickness, sorrow, had done their worst, and Mamie thought her heart would burst, as she no longer could provide for those dearer than all beside. To her they were her very life, none more dear since she'd been a wife. We'll leave them for a little space, another life in this tale to trace. John, too, had left the vale and glen, where life to him had pleasant been, for Mamie was his source of joy. She had gone, and alas, poor boy, what had been bliss to him before, now brought sorrow to his door, for every scene and every face reminded him of her, the place, full of delight when she was there, now held for him but deep despair. Thus John also went his way, and it knew him not from that day. With him, too, 10 years have passed. Flown, you may say, they've gone so fast. Our scene now, not a village neat, but city large, a busy street, where traffic of the densest kind thrust thoughts of rural scenes behind, where buildings, towering to the skies, attract attention by their size, and men, employed in deadly strife, for what? Money, their god, their life. We'll enter here, a monstrous pile, a building of the latest style, where almost dwells a merchant prince. Yes, dwells, for it is not long since this merchant from the lowest round, by centering all his will, has found the topmost limit of his fame, made for himself a mighty name. From east to west he is well known, in every village and small town. Is he happy? Well may we ask, since he has achieved this great task. A mighty power he has become. But then, well, what about his home? Has he any loving wife whose smile welcomes to his home, and the while, with gentle hands pressed to his face, tries to read his every thought, and trace, with anxious eyes that search him through, to see if there are troubles new, that she might ease them with her care, and thus with the dear one to share what she would bear full well as he, sharing with him the stormy sea of life, with all its joys and woes. His friends are hers, as are his foes. Home, with loving wife, children too, where love reigns supreme, known to few. Is this the incentive to his fame? This the power behind his name? No, this desire to lose all thought of just such scenes is what he sought. Plunging into the whirl and strife, they served for him as child and wife. No home, just where to lay his head. Business thoughts to all others dead. Happiness? Why, it long had flown. These many years he had not known. We'll look now at this merchant prince. We may have known him not long since. Engrossed in thoughts and sitting there, amidst a whirl of business care, a man with brow of noble height, fitted by nature for the fight. A man of men, who commands respect, one of great power and intellect. Years indeed have changed his face, still in the noble lines we trace our old friend John. What, can it be? Yes, dear reader, indeed 'tis he. Years have brought him a noble mien, with greatness and much worldly gain. But in his face are lines of care, for happiness is absent there. Yes, it is John, still kind and true, in all else the same John we knew. Older, more thoughtful, still the same, spite of the greatness of his name. See with what kindly smile he greets that little boy who from the streets with papers to his desk has come, trying to help with the small sum he may earn in this humble way those he loves, and from day to day he's here, and John has seen him oft, greeting him in tones mild and soft. "What is your name, my little lad?" we hear John say. His eyes looked sad, to see this one so young and fair, with sparkling eyes and curly hair, neatly dressed and winning ways. Mayhap he had seen better days. "John, sir," he in answering said, "and Ma is sick and Pa is dead." "Why, that is my name too, my boy," said John, and to the other's joy gave him a sum with which he fled to his poor mother, now ill in bed. It's Christmas Eve, and with what joy the mother greets her darling boy. A great hotel is our next scene, which, decked in festive holly green, and flashing lights and busy throng, a scene to be remembered long. We see crowds hurrying to and fro, some are coming while others go, making a picture full of life, a whirl, a rush, an endless strife, to one not used to city ways, filling with wonder and amaze. That little girl with bashful air selling flowers, she seems so fair. Many buy, and they little know what bring the blushes to her brow. 'Tis pleasure, yes, and also pain, to think that with this little gain she may restore to that mother dear health, happiness, and some good cheer. Nurtured with most tender care, out of place was her presence there. Why, here again is our friend John, amidst this whirl and busy throng. The child attracts him by her grace, something so winning in her face. Or does he see some likeness there of one who once to him was dear? He approaches her, asks her name. "Mamie, sir," quick the answer came. "Mamie," he said, to her surprise, looking into her deep dark eyes, her mother's eyes, yes, they were hers. No thought of this to John occurs. But the attraction was the same, as once again he heard her name. "Why are you here?" he kindly said.
"My ma is sick, and pa is dead," she answered in the simplest way.
John heard this once before today. He asked, "Have you a brother John?" He spoke so kind, the little one was drawn to him and answered yes. Did he not now the secret guess that she was Mamie's child, the name, ever dear to him, loved the same? For all his thoughts were of her still, through all these years, nor thought he ill, that the one he loved had fled from him, her own heart's choice to wed. He had loved her with unselfish love, his own heart crushed, still he strove her memory in his heart to shrine. To him she still was all divine. He knew not where she'd gone, nor thought the battle poor Mamie had fought. The shame, the poverty, the disgrace that she had found in that same place where he had made a name so great. It all seemed like the hand of fate that these two to Mamie so dear should receive from him Christmas cheer. Their story so impressed his mind, the names too, and he thought he'd find just where they lived. He would call on Christmas Day and see them all. Bought her flowers, her little store, with more than she had seen before. He then dismissed her to her home, telling the time that he would come. The bells ring out, 'tis Christmas Day, and kind Santa Claus with his sleigh has called at all the homes he knew. Dear reader, they were not a few. Hearts were made glad and faces bright that they'd been thought of in the night. Stockings filled and tables grown of many who dread want had known. We'll visit Mamie in her home. Here want and poverty had come. Old Santa Claus, too, had been here, bringing happiness and good cheer. A large tree in the parlor stood, decked with things useful and good. And Mamie's face, it shone with joy, as her daughter and darling boy repeat the story of the one who to them this great good had done. Who could he be? John, that's his name. She conned it o'er and o'er again. Could it be the kind John she knew so many long years ago, and who loved her? Yes, now she knew quite well. Alas, had she but let him tell his love for her before he came. That stranger, and whose very name, long since loathsome to her, and who had outraged every good she knew. Well, well, she thought, enough of this. 'Twas not to be. We do not miss the joy and bliss that might be ours, until they're gone, and all the powers cannot recall the past, nor say what may be in store for us today. Hark, is that a knock at the door? The clock has struck the hour of four, the hour he named, the stranger, John. Listen, children, he's come, he's come. They hastened to the door, 'tis he. They both are glad his face to see. Each takes a hand of the kind friend whose thoughtfulness deigned to send those rich gifts to that mother dear. Their hearts were full, they brought him near to their loved one and his own, the one who was his joy and crown. Mamie, John, was all that was said, as each the other's thoughts now read. She saw in his eyes the same deep love, now long dearer to her, far above all things else which this world could hold, and wondered why she'd been so cold. He saw all this and read her thought. His Mamie indeed is what he sought. Such a Christmas, so blessed with joy, their hearts were full without alloy. Another Christmas and another bride, and now 'tis John stands by her side. Mamie, older, yet full of grace, happiness now lights up her face.
Joy is hers, for she now has found in him all that her fancy crowned. Ring joyous bells with merry chime, this merry, merry Christmas time.
End of The Christmas Bride by Charles Nicholas Trivis.